Amen. Hallelujah. I want you, if you would, right now to join me in a moment of prayer for the Hackman family. As many of you may have already heard and know, Marcel went home to be with the Lord yesterday after a rather long physical battle. And so we want to lift up his family this morning. My heart is heavy for them today. And I'm sure that your heart is heavy for them as well. So would you join me? Let's pray for this family today. Father, we thank you for this precious family that means so much to the kingdom of God, to this body of believers, to this community. Lord, we thank you for Marcel. We thank you for the legacy that he leaves, the impact that he made. But today we rejoice with him because he's crossed the finish line. He fought a good fight. He finished his course. He kept the faith. And now there is laid up for him a crown of righteousness, which you alone, Lord, will give to him. You will place it upon his head. But Lord, those of us who know Marcel in any way at all know that he's going to take that crown because he's going to feel unworthy of it, and he's going to take it off of his head and he's going to lay it at your feet, and he's going to worship you like he's never worshiped you before. Strengthen this family today, Lord. Comfort them. Use us, Lord, the body of Christ, his family, his spiritual family. Use us, Lord, that your comfort, your encouragement would come through us to this precious family. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said amen. As I walked through the door, I sensed his presence, and I knew this was the place where love abounds. For this is his temple, Jehovah God abides here. Believe that this morning. So we are standing in his presence on holy ground. Come on, sing it with me again. We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. So let us praise Jesus now, for we are standing in his presence on holy ground. Come on, let's thank him for his presence this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Take your Bibles this morning, if you would, please. I want you to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Today is the first Sunday in what the Christian calendar refers to as Advent. The word Advent just simply means coming. The coming of a notable person, event, or thing. And when we use the word Advent in a Christian sense, it refers to the coming of Jesus, which is exactly what happened at Christmas time. Jesus came. And this morning, as we begin this Advent season, I want to talk to you about why Jesus came. The passage of Scripture that I'm about to read to you this morning is actually my favorite passage when it comes to the Christmas story. Now, I know that everybody probably has their favorite passage, most folks from Luke, or maybe from Isaiah chapter 9, and we'll look at some of those passages this morning, but this passage here in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, is my favorite Christmas passage. And maybe you've read it before, but you didn't look at it as a passage about Christmas. But listen to what the Apostle Paul says. He says, "You know how full of love and kindness our Lord Jesus Christ was." And then he reminds us of how loving and how kind the Lord is. And he shows us an expression of the love and the kindness of God. He said that though he was very rich, I like that. Though he was very rich, yet for your sakes, he became poor, so that by his poverty, he could make you rich. There's something that you need to know about Pastor Jamie and myself today that maybe you don't already know, and that is we are rich. Not rich from a world's perspective, but spiritually, we are rich. Why don't you just look at your neighbor and say, "I'm with Pastor, I'm rich today. As a child of God, I'm rich." Amen. Now, when I read that passage of Scripture, it tells me three things. First of all, it tells me that Jesus was rich. But not just rich. It tells us that he was very rich. Paul himself said it there in verse 9. Though he was very rich. Now that causes me, when I read that, to want to ask the question, well, how rich was he? Well, first of all, this morning, we need to understand and maybe be reminded that he was rich in his person. I mean, listen to what John says in John chapter 1, verse 1. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God," speaking about Jesus, "and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Now, you don't become any more rich than that in your person, than to be God himself. Listen to what the Bible tells us in John chapter 17, verse 5. At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, it says that he was God. At the end of his ministry, as he is praying just before he would go to the cross, he said, "And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began." May I tell you this morning that long before Jesus was Jesus, he was Jehovah. And he existed before anything on this earth was ever created. That's why in John chapter 8, verse 58, he would say to folks, "Even before Abraham was, I am." That's why he said in John chapter 10, verse 30, he said that "I am the Father." He said, "We are one." Notice what the Holy Spirit spoke through the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. He said, for a child is born to us. That speaks of the humanity of Jesus. But then notice what he says, a son is given to us. That speaks of his deity. That's what John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. But notice he said that a child is born to us, a son is given to us, and the government shall rest upon his shoulders. Listen to me, there is coming a day when Jesus Christ will rule and reign over all of the earth, and the government will rest on his shoulders. And then it said, this will be his royal titles, his names, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And then, of course, the announcement from the angel to Joseph about the birth of Jesus that confirms this very prophecy. He said this in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. He said, look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and he will be called Emmanuel, meaning God is with us. Oh, we need to be reminded today that he was rich in his person. He was and he is God. But not only was he rich in his person, he was also rich, look at this, in his position. Go back and look, if you would, in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. Listen to how Paul describes him. He said, you know how full of love and kindness our Lord Jesus Christ was. That word Lord in the Hebrew is the word Jehovah. That word Lord means that he is master, that he is ruler. But not only is he Lord, he's also Jesus. Jesus was his earthly name. That when the angel spoke to Joseph, said that you are to name him Jesus because he is going to save the people from their sins. And that's what the name Jesus means. It means Savior. It means deliverer. And that's the primary purpose that he came, was to deliver you and I from our bondage of sin. But not only is he Lord, and not only is he Jesus, he is also the Christ. And Christ means that he is the anointed one. That he was anointed by God to be our Savior. He was chosen and anointed by God to be our healer. He was chosen and anointed by God to be our deliverer. But not only is he Lord Jesus and Christ in his position, but Paul tells us in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 13 or verse 15, he says that he, Jesus, who is the blessed and only sovereign. That word sovereign means ruler. He's the only ruler, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That no king, that no other lord, that no other power will be able to oppose him and win. Hallelujah. One day every knee is going to bow, and one day every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He was rich in his person. He's God. He was rich in his position. But not only was he rich in person and in position, he was also rich in his power. Do you believe that this morning? Notice what the Bible tells us in Jeremiah 32, verse 17. Oh, sovereign Lord, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power. And I love this next sentence. Nothing is too hard for you.
You need to understand that this morning, that no matter what you're facing, no matter what you're going through, no matter what opposes you, that there is nothing too hard for God. Oh, Lord God, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power. When you go back to Genesis chapter 1 and 2, you find that everything that God created, he created it by his spoken word. And then Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3 tells us that not only did he create everything by just speaking the word, but he sustains everything. He holds everything together through the power of his word. Listen to what Acts 10:38 says. You know how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. Everybody say power. Oh, because along with the infilling of the Holy Spirit comes power. Amen. And God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. And so then Jesus went around doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. He was rich in power. That's why he could walk on water like we talked about last week. Amen. That's why he could walk into a graveyard where there was a demoniac of Gadara who was naked and out of his mind and in chains, and nothing that they had tried to do to deliver him was working. But Jesus spoke just a word. All he had to do was look at those demons within that man and say, go, and they were gone, and those demons came out of him and went into 2,000 pigs. That tells us that there were at least 2,000 demons inside of that man. But Jesus has all power, and Jesus had all authority in heaven and earth over all of the powers of evil. That's why he could look at sick people and say, be healed, and they were healed. That's why he could look at bound people and say, be free, and they were immediately set free. That's why he could take 5 loaves of bread and just a couple of fish and feed 5,000 men, not including the women and the children. Amen. He was rich in power. He was rich in position. He was rich in person, and he was rich in possessions. Rich in his possessions. Listen to what the Bible says in Exodus 19 and 5. For all the earth, he says, is mine. All of it. Pastor Eric has already alluded to that this morning. He tells us, in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 14, indeed, heaven and the highest heavens belong to the Lord your God. Also the earth with all that is in it. Psalm 24 and 1, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all its people belong to him. Haggai chapter 2 verse 8 says, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, declares the Lord. Oh, when you think about his richness, he was rich in his person. He was rich in his position. He was rich in his power. He was rich in his possessions. But what else did Paul tell us? He said that though he was very rich, he became poor. Let's look at exactly how he says it. He said, though he was very rich, look at this, this is important, yet for your sakes, not for his, but for your sakes, he became poor. Well, that leads me to want to ask the question, how poor did he become? Well, first of all, he became poor in his person. This is what we refer to as the incarnation. This is what Christmas is all about. You remember John chapter 1 verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. But then you go down to verse 14 and it says that the Word became flesh. and made his dwelling among us. Now, when we talk about the fact that he became poor, we're not necessarily just talking about the lifestyle that he lived while he was here on this earth. When we talk about the fact that he became poor, we're just mentioning the fact that God became a man. Deity became dust. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Paul said it like this in Philippians chapter 2, verse 7, that he made himself nothing. He took the humble position of a slave and appeared in human form. Though he was very rich, he became poor. He became a human being. He then knew what it was like to be tired and need sleep. He knew what it was like to be thirsty and need something to drink. He knew what it was like then to be hungry and need something to eat. He knew what it was like to have divine protection around his life. He perspired. He bled. Right? You say, well, why did he do that? Because God wanted more than just a knowledge of man and what man had to go through. God loved us so much that he wanted to experience it himself. And because of that, the Bible says that we do not have a high priest who cannot be touched by the feelings of our infirmities. In other words, he understands now. He knows what it's like to be abused. He knows what it's like to be rejected. He knows what it's like to be hurt. God himself became a man. Deity himself became dust. He became poor in his person. But not only did he become poor in his person, he also became poor in his position. Because listen, what Philippians 2 and 7 said, he made himself nothing and took the humble position of a slave. God, the Lord, Christ, King of kings, Lord of lords, when he comes to this earth, says, I have not come here to be served, but I've come to serve. He became poor in his position. But not only did he become poor in his person and his position, he also became poor in his power. You say, now hold on just a minute, Pastor. I've been with you all the way up until this point. But I don't believe that Jesus became poor in his power. No, not in the sense that the power of God, even while he was here on this earth, was continually demonstrating and working through his ministry. But power in the sense, he became poor in power in the sense that now as Jesus, the Son of God, he submits now his will to the will of the Father. Paul said it like this in Philippians 2 and 8. He said, and in human form, he obediently humbled himself. And he said it like this in John chapter 5, verse 19. He said, most assuredly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he sees the Father do. For whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner. We see this of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane when he says, Lord, if it is your will, let this cup pass from me. He had the power within himself as God, because even when he came here to this earth, he did not surrender his deity. He was still God. He was fully God and he was fully man. And the Bible is clear that he could have called a legion of angels to come and to have delivered him, but instead he submitted his will to the will of the Father. And he said, Lord, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me. Yet not my will, but your will be done. He became poor in his person, poor in his disposition, poor in his power, and he also became poor in his possessions. Material things did not mean anything to Jesus. He knew that they were only temporary, and he was focused on the eternal. He even said this in Matthew chapter 8, verse 20, that the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have their nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He became poor. Though he was very rich, for your sake and for my sake, he became poor. Why? Well, this is the whole message of Christmas. So that we could become rich. Hallelujah. Look again at what Paul said. He said, you know how full of love and kindness our Lord Jesus Christ was. And we see that demonstration of his love and kindness. That though he was very rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty he could make you rich. Well, that causes me to want to ask, how rich are we? Listen to me this morning. We are rich in person. Listen to what Paul said in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. He said, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. When I say that he who was very rich became poor so that we could become rich, I'm not talking about rich materialistically speaking. I'm talking about spiritual blessings. And Paul tells us, blessed be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Here's what that means. It means that you and I, we are now rich in person. Those of us who have accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we are rich in our person. Because listen to what John 1 and 12 says. But to all who believed and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. Oh, you should look at somebody right now and say, I'm a son of God. I'm a daughter of God today. I am rich in who I am. I am rich in my person. But not only would he say that we are rich in our person, we are also rich in position. Do you know what our position is now that we are followers of Christ? We are in Christ. That's our position. We're reminded of that in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, and the new is here. And he goes down to verse 21, and listen to what he says. God made him, Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in him, in Christ, we might become the righteousness of God. Now think about this. Picture two bank accounts. You got the account of Jesus, and in his account is nothing but righteousness. There is no sin whatsoever in his account. Then you look at our account before Christ, and there was no righteousness. There was all sin. You say, but hold on just a minute. I did a lot of right things even before I met Jesus. Listen, it doesn't matter what you did. Apart from God, apart from Christ, we are unrighteous. It's not our deeds that makes us righteous. It's our relationship with God through Jesus Christ that makes us righteous. And so Jesus had this account that was full of righteousness. We had an account that was full of sin. But here's what God did. God took the sin out of our account, and he put it over into the account of Jesus. And he took the righteousness out of Jesus' account, and he put it over into our account, so that now you and I, we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That means that you and I, we are rich in our position because we are hidden in Christ. Oh, hallelujah. Romans tells us in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, that there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are what? In Christ Jesus. I'm reminding you today, you are rich in your position because you are in Christ. In Christ. When God looks at us now, he doesn't see us. He sees Christ. And we are where? We are hidden inside of Christ Jesus. Oh, and he doesn't see our unrighteousness. He sees the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Oh, this is better than you think it is today. And only God could have that kind of a plan. We're rich in person. We're the children of God. We're rich in position. We're in Christ. And oh, let me remind you that we are rich in power. Because remember, Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. I shared this last week, but in Ephesians 1, when Paul was praying for those Ephesian believers, and I believe a prayer that he was even praying for all of us today, he said, I'm also praying that you will understand. Oh, if the church could ever understand this, we could change the world for the glory of God. But he said, I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe in him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in heavenly places. You need to know that the same power that worked through Jesus when he was here on this earth, that same power is in you and working through you as a follower of Jesus Christ. That's why Paul said in Ephesians 3:20 and 21, that God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or imagine, according to the power that what? Works in us and works through us. Did you know God can do exceeding abundantly above all great things through your life? If you will just humble yourself, if you'll submit yourself and say, God, I'm nothing without you, but with you, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You are rich in power. Start living like you're rich in power today. Hallelujah. We're rich in our person. We're rich in our position. We're rich in our power. And we are rich in possessions. Not the kind of possessions that maybe some of you are thinking about. Because let me tell you something. All of us, before we met Jesus, it didn't matter how much money we had. We could have had millions, billions of dollars. We could have lived in the biggest of houses. Driven the most expensive of cars. But let me tell you something. Before Christ, we were poor. You may have been rich, materialistically speaking, but spiritually speaking, every single one of us, we were broke. We were poor. But now, because of Jesus, that even though he was very rich, for your sake, for my sake, he became poor so that through his poverty, you and I could be rich. rich in possessions. Notice what Romans 8, 16 and 17 says. And the team can go ahead and get ready to come and help me close this morning. But in Romans 8, 16, Paul said, "For his Holy Spirit speaks to us deep in our hearts and tells us that we are God's children." Let me ask you, can you hear the Holy Spirit telling you that this morning? Oh, he's deep in your heart. He's telling you that you're a child of God. And here's what he wants you to know. And since we are his children, we will share his treasures. For everything God gives to his son, Christ, is ours too. Oh, we ought to thank God for every spiritual blessing here this morning. We think about the kingdom of God as righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. So as followers of Jesus Christ, we are rich because we have in our account the righteousness of God. We have the joy of the Lord. Not the kind of joy that the world has that's based upon their circumstances. The world may be happy sometimes, but they can't experience real joy. Peace that passes all understanding. Again, a peace that's not based on our circumstances, but it's a peace that gets us through our circumstances. Hallelujah. That's why Jesus said this. He said, "Whatever you do, don't lay up for yourself treasures on this earth, where moths and rust corrupt and thieves can break in and steal." It's been about 20 years ago, but man, I had a suit that I loved. It was my go-to suit. You know, if it was a wedding or a funeral or a special event, man, I'd pull that suit out. And every time I'd wear that suit, Jamie would be like, "Ooh, honey, you look good in that suit." And I had gone a while without wearing that suit. And I didn't store it correctly. And I went and got my suit. And I put the coat on. And there were holes all up in my suit where moths had destroyed that suit. When we were living in Ohio, it had always been a dream of mine to restore a 1964 and a half Ford Mustang. So I was looking through the want ads, and I found a 1964 and a half Mustang, black with white interior, exactly what I was looking for. And I went and I looked at this Mustang, and the girl was asking like $3,000 for it, and I got her all the way down to $1,500. And I loaded that Mustang on a trailer and I pulled it back home. And man, I'm telling you, I was so excited. And I kept wondering when I was looking out my rearview mirror, pulling that Mustang out of her yard, why she had such a big old smile on her face. And I got that car home and I put it up on jack stands. It was worthless. It was eat up with rust. Moths and rust corrupt. When we lived in Kansas, we had some thieves that broke into our house and stole some things that were valuable to us. Now, you know what? If your joy and your hope and your peace are attached to those kinds of things, as long as you have them, you're happy. But the moment you lose them, you're sad. And that's why Jesus said, don't lay up for yourselves treasures here on this earth. Why, a moth can destroy that. Rust can corrupt that. Thieves can break in and steal. So he said, instead, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, We don't got no moths up here in heaven, God would say. I know that's not good English, but that's the way I feel it. Don't have any moths in heaven. There's not any rust in heaven. There are no thieves in heaven. And he said, you need to lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust does not corrupt and where thieves cannot break in and steal. I like what Peter said when he said that because we are now sons and daughters of God, that we have an inheritance, incorruptible and undefiled, that's reserved where? In heaven for us. Oh, listen to me this morning. Right now, we may be sharing in the sufferings of Christ, but one day we are going to share in the glory of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. And that's the whole message of Christmas. That's the whole message of Advent. That he who was very rich, he for our sakes became poor so that you and I could be rich. Hallelujah. Oh, why don't you stand this morning and thank God for his blessings in your life today. For his goodness in your life today. I'm going to ask the prayer team, if you would please, to come. You need to know that a part of these blessings that are available to you today, one is salvation. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, make this the best Christmas season ever. You know, somebody can give you the greatest gift ever, but if you don't open it and receive it, what good does it do? God gave us the greatest gift that's ever been given to mankind when he gave us his only son. But that gift cannot change your life until you open the gift and receive the gift. Would you receive him today? Would you just admit to him and say, Lord Jesus, I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I thank you that you became poor so that I could become rich. Lord, forgive me of my sins. I cry out to you, Lord, and you said that whoever cries out to you, whoever calls on the name of the Lord can be saved. And Jesus, I believe everything that this preacher has said today about you. I believe that you are God. I believe that you did leave heaven and you came here to this earth. That deity became dust. That you became Jesus, my Savior. And that you are my Lord. I believe that you lived a perfect, sinless life while you were here. And I believe that you shed your blood for me. I believe that you died on the cross for me. I believe that you rose again, and I believe you're alive today. Listen, if you believe that sincerely in your heart and you confess it with your mouth, right now the Bible says you are saved. Maybe it's healing that you need this morning. I still believe in a God who heals. Maybe you need some deliverance today, some freedom. Maybe you've gotten too attached to this world, too attached to things of this world. And you need to become detached. You need freedom. I just want to tell you this morning, whatever it is you need to make you whole, whatever it is you need to make you complete, Jesus, who was very rich, became poor so that you could have and receive what you need today. These prayer partners are here. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior today, you need to come to one of these prayer partners. You need to tell them what's happened. If you need further prayer, you need to come to one of these prayer partners. They've got some information they want to put into your hands that will help you as you begin this journey with the Lord today. Father, we thank you today for your goodness. We thank you today for your blessings. And we rejoice in the Lord always. Hallelujah. Come on, let's pray and let's worship him.